Well, good evening and welcome. Thank you for joining us in this wonderful event honoring Graywolf Press, and also to celebrate the World of Voices exhibit that is next door in the Elmer Andersen Library. I'm Wendy Lougee, the University Librarian here, and it's my privilege to host this evening's event. But I do want to thank our co-sponsors as well, Graywolf Press, of course, and the Friends of the University Libraries for their support. Now, when the University Libraries acquired the Graywolf Press archives in 2009, we began to forge a wonderful relationship which continues to flourish today, a fabulous, fabulous partnership. And special thanks to Fiona McCrae and her staff for their generosity and support in making the Graywolf archives available to all around the world. And what a treasure it is. The collection adds enormous depth and diversity to our archives. In fact, it's the best place in our literary archives to find the rich concentration of women writers and writers of color. The diversity is captured in the name of the exhibit that I hope you'll see later, A World of Voices. Now, we have many reasons to celebrate Graywolf Press. First, obviously, it's a nationally acclaimed independent publisher. And second, it brings great prominence to the Twin Cities, and it's an important literary center that it creates. And third, it had the wisdom, of course, to entrust us with their archives, and we're extremely proud of that. But most important, Graywolf continues to carry the banner of literary excellence. And clearly, Graywolf's flame burns bright as the accolades pour in. Thanks to all of you, the writers who are in the audience tonight, the readers among us who buy the books, and especially to Scott Walker and Fiona McCrae for this gift to the world of your archives. Truly amazing. And now it's my privilege to introduce Cecily Marcus, who is the curator of the Upper Midwest Literary Archives. Cecily?
Hi, everybody. It's great to see you here tonight. I'm Cecily Marcus. I am the curator of the Upper Midwest Literary Archives, and it's great to celebrate this wonderful collaboration between the University of Minnesota Library Archives and Special Collections and Graywolf Press, both in the creation and care of the Graywolf Press collection and also in the exhibit that we're here to celebrate tonight. And I hope you will follow us next door to Elmer L. Andersen Library to see the exhibit on the second and third floors after the program. Before I say just a couple of words about the Upper Midwest Literary Archives, I wanted to say some words of thanks. Thanks to Graywolf Press and the Friends of the University Libraries for making tonight possible. I also want to thank Upper Midwest Literary Archives Assistant Curator Kate Huida for her leadership in curating the exhibit, A World of Voices, Darren Terpstra for his design, Rebecca Tuve, Carly Rumel, Pearl Perry, Chris Kiesling, and the staff of Digital Library Services for making all of this possible. But really, the exhibit wouldn't exist without the leadership and help of Leslie Johnson at Graywolf, as well as Fiona McCrae, Marissa Atkinson, and the Graywolf staff, many of whom took some things off of their walls and out of their offices so that we could bring them in to the library for you to see. I also want to thank University Librarian Wendy Lougee and her staff for all of their work. It's a lot of fun to work with the Upper Midwest Literary Archives. This is the home of the Graywolf Press Collection and the Scott Walker Collection. The archives are the home of the papers of writers and publishers who claim the Upper Midwest as their own, and be they poets, novelists, folk artists, editors. It is in these thousands of boxes and folders and in these pages that we see the work, the labor, and sometimes the blood of creating novels, poetry, narrative nonfiction, and everything else. These collections are intimate and eye-opening. From the notes on the back of napkins, to rejection letters, to editor's marks, to an artist's attempt to create that right book cover, all of this is contained. We hope that the Upper Midwest Literary Archives honors the work of our writers and publishers by preserving their collections and making them accessible to students, scholars, and the general public. These collections and all of the other archives and archives and special collections here in Elmer L. Andersen Library are free. They're open to the public. You need not have a student ID or any kind of official affiliation with the university. Please come and go through our boxes. It's now my pleasure to introduce Margaret Telfer, president-elect of the Friends of the Libraries and longtime supporter and former board chair of Graywolf Press. Thank you, Margaret.
Thank you, Cecily. It's my privilege to introduce our speakers this evening. But first, I want to acknowledge a few of the many people here this evening who've made Graywolf Press what it is today. Welcome to Tree Swenson. I just saw you, there you are, who was there at the beginning after co-founding Copper Canyon Press. Jim Sitter. Is he in the room? I don't see him. Who bookseller and distributor and fundraiser extraordinaire who's responsible for the presence in Minnesota of so many of the things we treasure, including among them Minnesota Center for Book Arts, Coffee House Press, and Graywolf Press. Gail C., who with Kay Sexton helped to welcome Scott Walker to Minnesota in 1985, and who was instrumental in bringing Fiona McCrae to Minnesota in 1994. Paige Coles, there you are, dear, who led the press during the leadership transition in 1994 and recently chaired our 40th anniversary celebrations. Rick Simonson, I saw you, a legendary bookseller from Elliott Bay Books in Seattle and early friend and collaborator with the press. There are many more of you here. There are editors, authors, employees, past and present, interns, board members, past and present, National Council members, funders, and most importantly, readers. Each of you a vital contributor to the world of voices that is Graywolf Press. Thank you all for coming tonight and for all you've done. On stage soon, there are going to be two people who have led Graywolf Press during the last 41 years of its existence. Scott Walker, who in 1974, along with Kathleen Foster, used a letterpress to produce the first volume of a magazine he called 12 Poems. From the beginning, Scott committed to work of quality, both in content and physical appearance, publishing Tess Gallagher and others, in chapbooks that were hand-set and hand-sewn. In 1985, as the demand for his beautiful books and for funding grew, Scott made the difficult but wise decision to move the press to St. Paul into Jim Sitter's apartment on Selby Avenue, from which the MCBA offices had just vacated. Scott has contributed many of the items you'll see in this exhibit, plus many more that remain in the cavern. He's been a publishing visionary for many years. When he left the press in 1994, it was one of the top five nonprofit presses in the country, which it remains today. He journeyed from his home in Portland, Oregon to be here tonight. Welcome, Scott, and thank you. In conversation with Scott is Fiona McCrae, publisher of Graywolf Press for the last 21 years. She hasn't changed Scott's vision for the press, only strengthened and expanded it, so that now Graywolf is among the most admired and awarded press, profit or non, in the country. From Faber and Faber, Fiona came to Graywolf in 1994 with a great appreciation for good publishing, a willingness to lead, edit, and fundraise, and an ability to make everyone she spoke to feel just a little bit smarter. Don't you think? In her first years, she published, among others, poets Carl Phillips, Eamon Grennan, and Vijay Seshadri. In her second year, Jane Kenyon's selected works. All these books are still in print. Under her leadership, the press has expanded its editorial model from the single editor to a team of editors. They've published good writing, well-edited, beautifully produced, and well-promoted. Graywolf authors have been nominated for and won national and international awards, a Pulitzer for that same Vijay Seshadri, National Book Critics Circle Award for Eula Biss's Notes from No Man's Land, National Book Award for Mary Shivist, the Impact Dublin Literary Award, the biggest in the world, to two of our authors, Per Pedersen for Outstealing Horses, and to Kevin Barry for City of Bohane. This year, so far, Claudia Rankine's book, Citizen, edited by Jeff Schatz, won the National Book Critics Circle Award for Poetry and the Forward Prize in London. The list of awards and important authors is long and varied and impressive, but I'll stop there. It's just always humbling to contemplate it. Recently in New York, Fiona herself received an award from the magazine Guernica, which she characteristically accepted on behalf of the entire staff. She is widely admired in the literary world as a sought-after speaker and someone we're so proud to call our own. After the conversation with our two publishers, you'll hear short readings from four longtime Graywolf authors. Each has chosen a poem. Actually, I think it's a little bit fluid what they've chosen. A poem or short piece from an earlier Graywolf book and something from recent work. Is that about right? You'll hear from noted critic and essayist Sven Birkerts, author of Changing the Subject and editor of the literary journal Agni. Two local literary lights who we know well, Jim Moore, author of seven books of poetry, and Mary Frances Rockcastle, author of two novels with Graywolf. And finally, Vijay Seshadri, winner of the Pulitzer Prize in Poetry for three sections and the James Laughlin Award for The Long Meadow. Please join me now in welcoming Graywolf publishers Scott Walker and Fiona McCrae, who will be interviewed by curator Cecily Marcus.
So I've already told Fiona and Scott that my goal here is to say as little as possible, because I think who we really want to hear from is both of you. So, you know, to start off, it's really the same question. You good? Could both of you talk to us about what, Scott, for you, what attracted you to the idea of starting the press? What kept you going, changing, moving as the press exploded and grew? And for you, Fiona, what attracted you to the press when you were working in London? What excites you about it now?
Thank you. I loved literature and even liked contemporary writers and what they wrote. And in college, I worked on a couple of literary magazines that got my appetite whetted, and then later started the press in the home of Copper Canyon Press with Sam Hamill and Tree Swenson. First starting out as a magazine called 12 Poems. There were 13 poems in every issue. The last two issues of which were devoted to the work of a single author. And I kind of discovered at that point that I was more of an album person than a song person and preferred the work of an author. When I was in high school, I had a sample book of handmade papers in my sock drawer that I would take out and look at now and then. So I was always interested in handmade books, and I read every biography I could of magazines and newspapers, and you know, the notion of publishing fascinated me. So to combine really interesting writing with a well-made, well-constructed, built-to-last book seemed like a good thing to do. So basically, idealism combined with absolutely no business sense at all. Because one thing I loved most is to take, you know, Tess Gallagher's book, for instance, first book that we did, took two people 8 months of work on a treadle-operated press every single day, handset type, all that stuff. And I wanted to put it at a price that people could afford, so the regular reader could afford to buy that kind of a book. So I think we, you know, probably must have made like 8 cents an hour for that time, because the books were priced at $4, and we, of course, sold them to the bookstores for $2.40 or something, and sold out in 4 months. So anyway, it was a combination of interest in writing, a regard for craft, and the desire to get the word out.
And for you, Fiona, what was the first thing you heard about Graywolf, and why did you come here for
it? That's an excellent question. And I'm going to answer it, but I just have to express that it really is a thrill to be here, sitting beside the founder of Graywolf Press. 20, I've been waiting 21 years for this. Thank you for doing the exhibition and hosting us. It's interesting to think about Scott, as I admire him so much, A, for having that guts for starting Graywolf, and also for his production values, and which I never came from that high production design area of publishing. That wasn't a high interest for me, and I started publishing with earphones over my ears and being dictated to by editors at Faber and Faber. But when I grew up a little bit there, I started to take on my own books and work with Robert McCrum. And this afternoon I was showing Scott a letter that I wrote him in 1988, turning one Graywolf book down but requesting information about another book that a Cuban writer living in London who told me it was the best book in the whole world. And so I started to track the Graywolf catalog. I liked how it looked, and it was Graywolf and North Point, which is not going anymore, that I really paid attention to. And then I moved in 91 to the Boston office of Faber and Faber, which in America was a small press. And I got, there were a lot of the literary magazines like Agni, where Sven works and is the editor of, but not that many literary presses. And I remember starting to talk to some of the people in Boston and saying, oh, it would be great if we could publish poetry at Faber. And some of the sales reps, I remember saying, well, that's so difficult, but, you know, Graywolf manages it. And then when I was at Faber, we bid on a book. It was Tim Winton, the Cloud Street. And Graywolf got it. And then I went to the trade show, and Tim Winton was there, and someone said, well, of course, you know, Graywolf got extra funding, and they brought the writer from Australia. And I remember thinking, I don't know that we could have done that. And then I met Scott Walker. I met him and the Dan Halpin, who was running Echo. And, you know, it was so exciting to meet you both. And then when I was casting about for a new job, I was thinking that there was something about Graywolf, that people loved Graywolf in the way that they had that about Faber. But the American Faber wasn't always, it didn't have that quite that aesthetic of looking for the literary stuff. We found it, but it was run a little bit like, you know, I felt that the for-profit way in which Faber Boston was run was very much short-term and at the expense of the books for the long-term, and not, in fact, how the Faber London had been run. Hmm. That's not for being tweeted and so on. But that's between us. So. We managed to take on Sven, for example, at Faber, but there were some challenges, and we had to keep coming up against marketing people. And so I just got attracted to the nonprofit model. And I remember when I was going to start at Graywolf, somebody in Boston said, Well, one well-known poet said, oh, Graywolf, they do beautiful books. That was Frank Bidart. And then, I just caught Tree. You know, Tree was encouraging me to go. And then another friend said, oh, Graywolf, I always think of that as something that we made, that we all made. And I always liked it that you didn't call it Walker Press, you called it Graywolf, and the logo had three, that it was, that there was something inclusive about it. And I liked the way Margaret said I didn't change Graywolf, but just tried to sort of expand it. And I wrote to you, didn't I, after I started, that anything that happens at Graywolf that I do will be on your shoulders, you know, that it, we were just building. And it was great fun in those early days to... it's a different office now, but we had the main office, and then off that was the warehouse with all a copy of all the books that had been published. Not all the, not every single copy of each edition, but there was a representative. And I remember walking into that warehouse and feeling so proud, you know, and to of my inheritance on your behalf. I was proud of your book. Sorry, was that too long of an
answer? No, that was great, and actually it leads to the next question, is why Minneapolis? Why did you move the press to Minneapolis and not New York or somewhere else? And what does being in Minneapolis allow you to do, Fiona, that maybe you couldn't do if you were somewhere else?
For me, it was, I actually, in Port Townsend, Washington, which is a town of about 8,000 people, on the Olympic Peninsula, I gradually realized that there were no foundations. There was nobody we could ask for money, and that our ambitions were greater than what I could afford to do, funding it totally by labor. I mean, no matter, I was already working 16 hours a day, working 24 wouldn't have helped us. So I actually had decided, I'd done a little bit of traveling. People had asked me to talk, and so I saved up my frequent flyer points, and I was going to quit and go to Bermuda. And then Jim Sitter from the Twin City, he ran a book distribution at the time, and he and I had become phone friends and just sort of good brainstormers and sort of both ambitious people, you know, wouldn't it be great if this could happen type of people. He said, well, why don't, you know, think about coming to the Twin Cities. So I came out, long story short, and over the course of 2 weeks, I believe I arrived on January 3rd, without a car. It's really hard taking that bus up and down Selby Avenue in the cold. But then I just met a number of people. John Taylor was one from the Northwest Area Foundation early on, who was very influential, I think, who just showed the country boy how it was done here in the big city. And the reason I didn't go to New York is that they didn't ask.
Huh. Would you have gone if they had?
No, I wouldn't. I, you know, part of it was, you know, I felt like I had friends here. All I did was work back in the Northwest, there were a number of bookstores here. And I did start this little correspondence course with booksellers. So they would order three copies of a chat book. And so I would sell them for $3 each, which meant they had to pay $1.60 for them. And at the bottom of the invoice, I would write, hey, Tom, how you doing? Or, what's selling in the store? So we would just sort of start talking back and forth. And so I felt like I was entering a community right off that I already knew, which really was a shorthand for this is a very literate, artful, welcoming town. So that made me feel that was a, you know, it's a city, but it really has that kind of small town neighborliness to it that made it special for me at the time.
And Fiona, what does being here afford you? What kind of freedom? What kind of limitations?
I think that it's it is a good place for these literary presses to flourish. There's Graywolf, Coffee House, Milkweed, Rain Taxi, that's Milkweed, The Loft, and there's an understanding with enough of the philanthropic community that what we do is important. And I think the rest of the country appreciates the success of the presses that are not in New York, and that we're not all talking about the same things and chasing all the same writers. Obviously, there's some overlaps. And I just think it allows us to have a different perspective. I travel to New York quite a lot, but sort of come out. And I think that the funding combined with the lower prices of things here means that there's a can be a culture of experiment and risk-taking. And I think that's only... I think it's only getting more true as you see how expensive San Francisco and New York are becoming. I mean, Manhattan was going out maybe to Brooklyn. It's going on there, but it's something I've really appreciated. And I think that the things go through cycles of, you know, like when you started, but if the larger houses, if they're going through a risk-taking or risk-avoiding time. So I think that things, when they start not taking risks because they're more concerned with finances, things start going a little bit more homogenous in the mainstream, so there's more opportunities for variety and risk out here. No limits whatsoever. The whole country is closer, but, you know, you can get anywhere you want fast, and the internet's made a big difference to connecting everybody and the staff and so on.
So how does the internet work with this? I mean, from the very start, you know, chatbooks, letterpress, that is technology. Now ebooks, the internet, social media. What role does technology have in how you thought about what you're doing?
I think it's interesting that what I was saying before about, like, you were more into the physical book than I ever was, but I also think you were more into the internet. I admire, sort of out in front.
The autobiography that I will not write would be called The 500-Year Career, because I started out as a hand printer and, you know, ended up coding Kindle books. I don't think there's a difference at all. A pencil, you know, a rock is a technology. It's just about the transmission of a well-made piece of thought in whatever form and transmitting that to an audience. So I think there are possibly issues of attention span that need to be considered, but I think technologies just present different opportunities to reach different audiences in different ways.
I agree with that.
I actually sort of wonder that with even in the book industry now, the preponderance of really bad design and put out in books that will melt and go into the waste heap in 5 years just because the paper won't last, will create an opportunity for people to create and for readers to buy books that are well designed, well made, treated with respect through the whole process, and then delivered to a ready and waiting audience? Because I think that it's a hunger that should remain.
Yeah. You can actually see the young people. We have lots of young people over there. Put your hands up if you thoroughly enjoy the physical book. See? Look at that. That's what you see over and over again. It's fascinating that it's not like records that are sort of just, you know, become sort of relics at the side, but there's something very enduring about the books. And I said this we were interviewed, both of us, on the radio about this, and I was talking about how publishing is always breaking down into two branches of activity, and one is all around the editorial and the design and making the book and finding the writer, and then the other is getting it out. And I think the fact that there are so many publishers still in business shows that we're not just a middleman passing the writer straight to the reader. There is actually something that goes on there in the editorial process that is of value. And if we're not adding value as publisher in either the editorial or the marketing, or preferably both, then the author could just go behind our back with their technology. But as Sven Birkerts once said, I've quoted this many times, even when you're not here, that there's a way if you self-publish, just because your book is online, it's like having your name in the telephone directory doesn't mean that someone's going to phone you. You know, you need the publisher to get people to put your phone number in different places.
I hadn't thought about it that way. What's been the most fun thing you've worked on with Graywolf, both of you?
Somebody asked me, when was the moment that I knew Graywolf had kind of made it? The same guy who interviewed us on the radio. And I said, I never felt like Graywolf had made it. I felt like I was hanging by the fingernails from the edge of a cliff the entire time, like next month. But, you know, I think looking back on it, the most fun really was were the people involved, the writers. You know, even those, I had a writer in upstate New York who's a writer and translator. You know, the phone rang at 3 a.m, which is 6 a.m. his time, and he'd been up all night drinking. I knew that was Al. And then, you know, and other writers, you know, just, it really becomes an intimate, close relationship. And so for me, that was fun. And I think the people that I work with, it was a really good group of people in Graywolf over the years. And I think Fiona has more than carried that on. It's just the staff has just been fabulous. And the board members who, you know, that sort of positive feedback, that's fun. I mean, if you're hanging by your fingernails, it seems like fun.
It's hard to single one thing out, but we have some stuff about William Stafford at the over in the archive, and he has a poem about the way it is and about the thread that goes through things that you follow, and people ask you about the thread, and it's just thinking about it. I was thinking like it's always an exciting moment. You always feel like you're setting off. It's always opening up. It's always fresh. And yet there's this thread that goes through, and in the archives you can see like a postcard from Albert Goldbath sent to Scott in 1975, and then him doing silly things around our logo like 20 years later when he's being published by us. So I just think it's all the view from here when you're seeing the arc, and there's Mary Rockcastle sitting there who I think I was reading your book as I was arriving to work at Graywolf, and now then we published your next book, and VJ and Jim and Sven, all the continuities of the whole thing, that when you embark on it, you don't know that this is going to turn out to be a 20-year relationship, so, or, you know, 20 years so far.
Well, that section in the exhibit that you'll see after that is about long-time relationships,
yes,
with writers over time, and the section is called Great Loves That Live Forever, taken from the title of the book, or Claudia Rankine's Don't Let Me Be Lonely, which about, you know, all the different kind of writing that Graywolf has
and then with
supported.
Long relationships with, like, the College of St. Benedict, there's Mark Conway, and Bookmobile, there's Don Ripa. Like,
so what has it meant for both of you to have this archive here, both of your archives, that can, you know, attract students, that can inform publishing, that scholars can study, that we can curate exhibits from? Why is that important?
Because it's literary history.
It is.
In the making.
I'm thrilled it's at the Elmer L. Andersen Library.
Oh, that's nice.
Elmer was... Elmer was one of the earliest people I met in Minnesota, was a really fabulous supporter of the press. I met him at a party in those first 2 weeks, and he asked me if I would come to breakfast. And I knew he's a former governor, so of course, well, yes, of course. And he said, it's 5:30, too early. And I said, well, you know, what was I going to say? So I took a cab, and it was like 20 degrees below zero, and took a cab out to Roseville or wherever the heck it was, and he just was most erudite, gentle, well-read, generous man. And it was so typical, in a way, of so many people that I met here, from the people on the board and other places. But anyway, that's, it really touches me that it's all together in one place, and because I think it is an important part of the history.
And I think that the looking at the exhibition, it shows a bit what I was talking about earlier, about there is actually something that happens at a publisher beyond just passing the thing, and it's really, the exhibit gives you a cross-section of that, but shows there's design work, there's editorial work. I can't see Jeffrey Schatz, but Jeff Schatz with his green pencil, and you know, Katie Dublinski, I saw her, she's up there, you know. These people are sort of spending hours and hours working away and changing the manuscript slightly. It's invisible for the most part, you know. When you go into a bookstore, their books are just sitting quietly, they can't speak, you know, they're undramatic. And there is a little quiet drama. And I think it was you that said you didn't know how it would translate visually. You know, it's not a very, on first thought, you don't think what we're doing is particularly
boxes
visual.
Full of paper.
Yeah. How is that going to? So I think that there is a story, and as I was saying earlier, somebody just like today, we've got these, you know, four writers participating, and it's a day event, but it's actually connected to something that's been going on for many years and will go on for many years, and then to see that history is stored, and people can, the young people might become curious 10, 20, 30 years' time. I think it's nice. But coming from Faber, we were, in fact, I got my job because the archivist at Faber was friends with my mother and gave her the info. But, so, you know, there was a sense there that you have to have one eye on the future, and we had to, you know, sign all our letters with our surname so people would know in the future. So we talk about that at Graywolf to train us all to think that this is happening in this moment, but somebody in the future, including ourselves, might be interested in this. So, you know, keep it. And I don't know how you all are gonna cope with email. We don't know about that.
We're working on it.
Yeah,
I don't think anybody quite knows.
No, I think it's a question, isn't it?
Yeah. There's a lot of "I'll see you at 6" that, you know, may not have the same kind of historical impact as some other emails. Well, I have a number of other questions here, but I think we should let your writers read, and
definitely,
and we'll talk over wine next door. Thank you so much,
Thank you both.
Oh my, I hadn't looked in that direction. Good evening. We were sort of given the word to stay short, to be brief, and I will. I did want to say, just listening to all this and thinking, not so much as a Graywolf author, which I've been a very happy one for a long time, but long before that, sort of the thing that brought me into all this was bookstore culture. I worked for many, many years as a bookseller and a book dealer, used and rare and new and all of this, and got a certain feeling for books. And I just realized, sort of from looking and listening, something that was always has been true of Graywolf books can be summed up in three short words, but they're really good words. From a bookseller's perspective, and maybe a browser's perspective, when you're in a store and you see a Graywolf book, you sort of feel that time was taken. Something about it, the book stands out because it's clear that time was taken with it, which also says that time is often not taken with a great many other books, but that's the sort of underreported quality of goes on. So we were asked to briefly read both from a older established Graywolf classic and then something of our own more recent. I had to really think. I finally just decided to go with Per Pedersen, who I was happy to meet at a Grey Wolf event that was hosted in Brookline, Massachusetts a few years ago, and so I had that little sense of a brief personal connection. It's also a book that I loved, Outstealing Horses, and I love openings to things, so I'm just going to read the first two pages of that, and then I'm going to read a little short bit from a recently published book of mine. So, Outstealing Horses. Early November, it's 9 o'clock. The titmice are banging against the window. Sometimes they fly dizzily off after the impact. Other times they fall and lie struggling in the new snow until they can take off again. I don't know what they want, but I have. I look out the window at the forest. There's a reddish light over the trees by the lake. It is starting to blow. I can see the shape of the wind on the water. I live here now in a small house in the far east of Norway. A river flows into the lake, and it's not much of a river, and it gets shallow in the summer, but in the spring and autumn it runs briskly, and there are trout in it. I've caught some myself. The mouth of the river is only 100 meters from here. I can just see it from my kitchen window once the birch leaves have fallen, as now in November. There's a cottage down by the river that I can see when its lights are on if I go out onto my doorstep. A man lives there. He is older than I am, I think, or he seems to be. But perhaps that's because I do not realize what I look like myself, or life has been tougher for him than it has been for me. I cannot rule that out. He has a dog, a border collie. I have a bird table on a pole a little way out. A little way out in my yard. When it is getting light in the morning, I sit at the kitchen table with a cup of coffee and I watch them come fluttering in. I've seen 8 different species so far, which is more than anywhere else I've lived, but only the titmice fly into the window. I have lived in many places. Now I'm here. When the light comes, I've been awake for several hours, stoked the fire, walked around, read yesterday's paper, washed yesterday's dishes. There were not many. Listened to the BBC. I keep the radio on most of the day. I listen to the news. Cannot break that habit, but I do not know what to make of it anymore. They say 67 is no age, not nowadays, and it does not feel like it either. I feel pretty spry. But when I listen to the news, it no longer has the same place in my life. It does not affect my view of the world as it once did. Maybe there is something wrong with the news, the way it is reported. Maybe there's too much of it. The good thing about the BBC's World Service, which is broadcast early in the morning, is that everything sounds foreign, that nothing is said about Norway, and that I can get updated on the position of countries like Jamaica, Pakistan, India, and Sri Lanka in a sport such as cricket, a game I have never seen played and never will see, if I have a say in the matter. But what I have noticed is that the, quote, motherland, England, is constantly being beaten. That's always something. I'll stop there with Pear. I realized as I was reading, unintended, but there's a slight little through line. Through lines seem to be our theme this evening. Let's see if you see where the through line is. Okay, yeah, not too long. My induction into the late modern or postmodern age came on March 28, 1979, with the news of the accident at the Three Mile Island nuclear facility in Middletown, Pennsylvania. On that day, uninterrupted radio and television bulletins reported an unprecedented system collapse and the impending release of enormous quantities of radioactive material. Enough, it was said, to contaminate the whole eastern seaboard. The drama threw me into a state of inner panic. I could not stop listening as, hour by hour, the situation developed. The crisis, the magnitude of its danger, the seemingly inadequate efforts at contamination. at containment. I'm sorry, the seemingly inadequate efforts at containment. I felt at my own core in meltdown. And that terrifying intensity was the first thing I thought of on the morning of September 11, 2001, when the reports and images were coming at us one hard upon the next, of a city drowning in black smoke, of hijacked aircraft, of other possible targets. I was suddenly right back in that tiny room in Cambridge two decades earlier, listening to my battery-powered radio, monitoring the reported shape and distribution of the radioactive plume that for a long period looked to be headed up the eastern seacoast, likewise half convinced that the apocalypse was finally at hand. What I realized in those hours in my room, what I got in my gut in a way I had never really gotten before, not even during the atom bomb anxieties of my childhood, was that my assumption of the local, of the safe sovereignty of place had been shattered. Something happening very far away was very possibly going to change my life, all our lives, and that something was a power that was human-created and invisible. Certainly those original nuclear paranoias had deeply shaken me, but for some reason they hadn't quite uprooted my worldview. Now I felt real change happening. Though everything outside my window looked the same as it ever had, it was all made different by this new knowledge. Yesterday's tree, the parked cars, the neighbor boy's bike, their positions were unchanged, but the air surrounding them was no longer the same. TMI, that was the acronym by which Three Mile Island entered our lore. Journalists wrote TMI as they now write 9/11 or Katrina, and everyone knew what it meant. Then years went by, the time of a half generation, and of course the terrifying recollection waned. But, and here's the sublime irony, as one sense of TMI gradually faded, another quietly arose to take its place. I remember I was sitting at dinner just a few years back, all of us listening to my son, Liam, telling about something he'd heard at school, giving account, when all of a sudden his older sister, Mara, dramatically clapped her hands over her ears and said, TMI, TMI, meaning, as she explained when she saw my confused expression, too much information. This latter meaning of the acronym has gone out now to whatever linguistic boneyard old cliches go to. But for the opportunistic essayist looking to write about the inundation of our whole culture, our world, by data, and the transfiguration of our ways of living by information technologies, no coincidence of initials could be more apt. And I'll stop there. Thank you. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Mary Rockcastle. I was told to say my name because otherwise no one would know who you are. So I just need to say that when you get the call that your book is going to be published, it changes your life. And Scott Walker gave me that call many years ago and said, we want to buy your book, Rainy Lake. And I thought, well, now my life has begun. And then Scott left and Fiona inherited that book. And when I met you for the first time, you really scared me. I found you very scary. I don't find you scary most of the time anymore, just sometimes. And I thought, I don't know if she'd really like my book, but she's being very nice about it and very polite, so just shut up and be happy. And then years later, when I had written an early version of In Caddis Wood, which was not right, and Graywolf turned it down, and then I saw Fiona at a loft lunch, and you very politely said, well, what have you been working on? And I said, well, I've been working on a revision of that book, and you looked at me as if I'd lost my mind. But because you're so polite, you said, well, then tell me about it. And I told you about it, and you said, oh, well, you're going to send it to Graywolf, aren't you? And then I got the email that said, the lights are blinking green over here. And I was sitting in my office and thought, does that mean they want it? So I'll always be grateful to Graywolf Press. I chose to read Elizabeth Alexander's The Venus Hottentot from the book of that name. I've taught the book many times. I've taught many of Graywolf's books. And this one, the last time I taught it was in a class that focused on research and the writer, how writers use research. And so the students used this poem as a prompt for doing research about a historical figure and then writing either poetry or prose. And the Venus Hottentot was Sarji Bartman, a Khoikhoi woman from South Africa who was brought to Europe in 1810. And because of her large buttocks, which was representative of Khoikhoi women, she was displayed in circuses and in private salons. She only lived a few years, but right before she died, a French naturalist, Georges Cuvier, started examining her, and after she died, he put her skeleton and parts of her body on display at a museum. So Elizabeth Alexander wrote this poem, and it is in two voices. The first voice is Cuvier. One, Cuvier, science, science, science. Everything is beautiful, blown up beneath my glass. Colors dazzle insect wings. A drop of water swirls like marble. Ordinary crumbs become stalactites set in perfect angles of geometry I'd thought impossible. Few will ever see what I see through this microscope. Cranial measurements crowd my notebook pages, and I am moving closer, close to how these numbers signify aspects of national character. Her genitalia will float inside a labeled pickling jar in the Musée de l'Homme on a shelf above Broca's brain, the Venus Hottentot. Elegant facts await me. Small things in this world are mine. And the rest of it, section two, is from Sarji's point of view, her voice. There is unexpected sun today in London, and the clouds that most days sift into this cage where I am working have dispersed. I am a black cutout against a captive blue sky, pivoting nude so the paying audience can view my naked buttocks. I am called Venus Hottentot. I left Cape Town with a promise of revenue, half the profits and my passage home, a boon. Master's brother proposed the trip. The magistrate granted me leave. I would return to my family, a duchess, with watered silk dresses and money to grow food. Silver scissors, a lorgnette, voile and tulle instead of flax, cerulean blue instead of indigo. My brother would devour sugar-studded nonpareil, pale taffy, damask plums. That was years ago. London circuses are florid and filthy, swarming with cabbage, smelling citizens who stare and query, is it muscle, bone, or fat? My neighbor to the left is the sapient pig, the only scholar of his race. He plays at cards, tells time and fortunes by scraping his hooves. Behind me is Prince Carmi, who arches like a rubber tree and stares back at the crowd from under the crook of his knee. A professional animal trainer shouts my cues. There are singing mice here, the ball of Duchess du Barry. In the engraving, I lurch toward the belle dame, mad-eyed, and they swoon. Men in capes and pince-nez shield them. Tassels dance at my hips. In this newspaper lithograph, my buttocks are shown swollen and luminous as a planet. Monsieur Cuvier investigates between my legs, poking, prodding, sure of his hypothesis. I half expect him to pull silk scarves from inside me, paper poppies, then a rabbit. He complains at my scent and does not think I comprehend, but I speak English. I speak Dutch. I speak a little French as well, and languages Monsieur Cuvier will never even know have names. Now I am bitter, and now I am sick. I eat brown bread, drink rancid broth. I miss good sun, miss mother's sadza. My stomach is frequently queasy from mutton chops, pale potatoes, blood sausage. I was certain that this would be better than farm life. I am the family entrepreneur. But there are hours in every day to conjure my imaginary daughters in banana skirts and ostrich feather fans. Since my own genitals are public, I have made other parts private. In my silence, I possess mouth, larynx, brain in a single gesture. I rub my hair with lanolin and pose in profile like a painted Nubian archer, imagining gold leaf woven through my hair and diamonds. Observe the wordless odalisque. I have not forgotten my Khoisan clicks. My flexible tongue and healthy mouth bewilder this man with his rotting teeth. If he were to let me rise up from this table, I'd spirit his knives and cut out his black heart. Seal it with science fluid inside a bell jar. Place it on a low shelf in a white man's museum so the whole world could see it was shriveled and hard, geometric, deformed, unnatural. Yes. Elizabeth Alexander, and I'm going to read the first two pages from In Caddiswood. Chapter 1, Carl, Caddiswood, early June. Carl sits upright in bed and gazes into the furry dark. Something hot and galloping in the room, black walls leaping like a tilt-a-whirl, the steady boom of his heart. Terror, not from a dream either. Hallie sighs and turns into his arm. There is a stirring in the corner behind the glass door, and he remembers a similar movement that morning while he was weeding in the garden, a motion as of a bird startled, jarred into flight. Scanning the shadowy contours of the room, he sees the pale curtain, the silhouette of clothing hung on hooks. He concentrates on each breath, his eyes locked on the steepled pines that frame the edge of the porch, then pads across the wooden floor. The air outside is resinous, soft, completely still. Only the silver stream moves. Maybe it's the unnatural quiet that has awakened him, the absence of nighttime's customary clamor. Leaves, the soughing wind, whine of insects. The moon is sickle-shaped and bright, not a single cloud. Everything, trees, sky, birds, is watching. Without warning, the image of his own death comes upon him. Nothing concrete, no yellow car, no fire, no empty stairs, but the idea of it is so real he trembles. Look around, he counsels himself, the motionless meadow, the meandering hedgerows and flowery stream banks, the circular vegetable garden, this screen porch he's standing on, the wooden ledge beneath his hand. I made this place. I'm only 61 years old. I'm fine. He wants to stop the pitching balcony, the woods advancing toward him. He's had premonitions before at each of the touchstone moments of his life. The day his father was killed, that was the first one, and then the whole week before his mother died. The morning of Beatrice's accident and that awful March day when Hallie left him. Shaking himself, he adjusts the pillow in the Adirondack chair, pulled close to the screen the way he likes it, and sits. Anxiety needles through him. Cordelia is flying in from South America. Old friends whom he hasn't seen in years are coming. And Beatrice, he can't help worrying about her. Travel can be stressful, and he doesn't like her to put additional strain on her body. It's ridiculous, really, all this hoopla, more than he's ever experienced for the opening of a building. But it's the first retrospective the Weissman Museum has ever done on a Minnesota architect, Hallie reminds him. You should be proud. He is proud. His firm has won more than its share of competitions and awards. He believes he's living up to the aim he had as a young man to be a great architect, to elevate, in Louis Kahn's words, the circumstantial to the ideal. If he doesn't always achieve it, he continues to try. Not once has he ever considered lowering the bar. Maybe it's the word itself, retrospective, that bothers him. The focus on the work achieved, the career already made, finished. Isn't that what's implied? A career past its prime, the best work done. Thank you.
I'm Jim Moore. Even though I'm older than Mary Rockcastle, I feel like I've been trying to keep up with her and following her for most of my writing life, so I'm glad to be following her again tonight. What a great thing this is, to see Scott and Fiona and to hear them talk, to hear you talk about this press that has meant so much to so many of us. I'm at a point in life when I just really appreciate that I have a home in this sort of strange literary world of ours, and grateful too to the University of Minnesota, my alma mater, for making this home even more secure. And I look out there and I see you and I see so many people who have been involved for so long. Thank you so much for doing what you've been doing. So I'm gonna read a poem by Jim White. This is a good person to read because Scott initially published this book, The Salt Ecstasies, many years ago. And then under the new leadership of Fiona, it was republished recently with a great introductory essay by Mark Doty. Jim was a friend of mine, really more a mentor than a friend, only a few years older than me, but for various reasons had a great deal to teach me. And well, the thing I love about him most is what a great poet he was. He wrote a group of poems called, the whole group was called Poems of Submission. And in fact, a few years ago, Brick, the magazine in Canada, asked me if there was a book or a writer who was kind of lost that I would recommend. And I recommended Jim's book. And I recommended particularly these poems of submission. And later I got, before this was printed up in their magazine, I got a note from one of the editors saying, in Minnesota, if you're a poet and you're sending poems out to magazines, you call them poems of submission. And I thought, well, it's probably a good idea to do that. But so this one's called Submission to Pain. Giannis, my friend in the next bed, cries, tomorrow they'll cut his frozen fingers off. He has submitted that his hands will never know gathered dust or circle the chipped edge of a yellow bowl, even the perfunctory need to touch his penis, never to play by fingertip the lyre of his wife's hair or draw around slowly her nipples into rings of heat. Giannis, Hungarian-born, fought in the 56 revolt. The Russians left holes through which he stares long out the hospital window, a mother, grandmother, and father. We prowl the ward late at night before the Perkinen works. Pretty high once, he told me in Budapest, everything becomes blue with the moon, and it was not uncommon to see old blue horses by his house when he was a boy. Then he apologized, said the narcotic made his mind old and odd, odd like a poet's. So that poem and the other poems he wrote as he was nearing his death, he was ill for a long time. So I thought from my own poem that I'd read the first poem that was published in the first book that I did with Graywolf, Lightning at Dinner. The poem is called You Are Human, and it's one of a number of poems I've written over the years where I've tried to imagine the pleasure of what it would be like to not be human. You are human. But why not be this lake instead? Icy blue and the little white curls of waves, its absolute refusal to be human. Why not be a thing? Why not be a place you'd go to get away from your mother's frontal lobe eroding, as the faxed medical report has it? Why not a lovely blue turning green, and why not the removal of all feeling? Maybe she'd rather you be a lake, a way to lie still in the world, a melted down pool of snow, a place to rest. You could let yourself wash up on foreign shores, or be the surface across which boats might ply their trade, taking humans from the one shore in sun to the other in shade. You remember humans, don't you? The ones who row the boat, who act for all the world as if they know where they are going. Thanks.
I've been very happy with Graywolf. And it's been a long relationship and has always been a happy one. And I want to thank the press, and I want to thank Fiona and Jeff and the entire staff and for making me happy who am generally not happy. I'm going to read I'm going to finish by reading a poem by William Stafford, but I'm going to start by reading a poem that I had actually retired from my repertoire from three sections, and then I decided to bring it back in because of the recent Republican debates, which I've been watching with fascination and real interest. And it's a poem that's kind of inspired by immigration. It's called Trailing Clouds of Glory, which is, of course, from Wordsworth's Immortality Ode, and the lines go, "Trailing clouds of glory, did we come from God, who is our home?" And that is a poem about the migration of the soul into the body and the subsequent entrapment of the soul in materiality and in flesh, and the subsequent loss of its connection to its immortality. And I didn't choose the title for that reason. I chose it because of the 2009 Arizona immigration law, whereby if you looked like you were undocumented, the constabulary of that state could pull you over and ask you for your papers. And when I was young, I would have been kind of indignant about this. A whole host of things, among them the insult to the Constitution and to Anglo-Saxon jurisprudence going all the way back to the Magna Carta. But when I read the story in the Times, I thought, wow, what a great idea for a poem. And that's this poem, Trailing Clouds of Glory. Even though I'm an immigrant, the angel with the flaming sword seems fine with me. He unhooks the velvet rope. He ushers me into the club. Some activity in the mosh pit, a banquet here, a panhandler there, a gray curtain drawn down over the infinitely curving lunette, Jupiter in its crescent phase, huge, a vista of a waterfall with a rainbow in the spray, a few desultory orgies, a billboard of the snub-nosed electric car of the future. The inside is exactly the same as the outside, down to the MC in the yellow spats. So why the angel with the flaming sword, bringing in the sheep and waving away the goats, and the men with the binoculars, elbows resting on the roll bars of jeeps, peering into the desert? There is a border, but it is not fixed. It wavers, it shimmies, it rises and plunges into the unimaginable seventh dimension before erupting in a field of Dakota corn. On the F train to Manhattan yesterday, I sat across from a family threesome Guatemalan by the look of them. Delicate and archaic and Mayan, and obviously undocumented to the bone. They didn't seem anxious. The mother was laughing and squabbling with the daughter over a knockoff smartphone on which they were playing a video game together. The boy, maybe three, disdained their ruckus. I recognized the scowl on his face, the retrospective, maskless rage of inception. He looked just like my son when my son came out of his mother after 30 hours of labor, the head squashed, the lips swollen, the skin empurpled and hideous with blood and afterbirth. Out of the inflamed tunnel and into the cold room of harsh sounds. He looked right at me with his bleared eyes. He had a voice like Richard Burton's. He had an impressive command of the major English texts. I will do such things, what they are, yet I know not. But they shall be the terrors of the earth, he said. The child, he said, is father of the man. And, you know, I sometimes think William Stafford was waiting all his life for Graywolf Press, you know? And, one of the great American poets, and particularly important to me as Graywolf is because, you know, you all know, of course, that it's not named after the canine, but a river in the Olympic Peninsula, the Graywolf River. And, or at least I think so, isn't that true, Scott? Yeah. And I lived in the Pacific Northwest from when I was 20 to when I was 28, and for 5 years I lived in Oregon. And I'm particularly grateful to be allowed to read this poem, and it's probably his most famous poem. And he's been gathered into the Graywolf fold and is published by Graywolf, and which is a very, very good thing, I think. Traveling through the dark. Traveling through the dark, I found a deer dead on the edge of the Wilson River Road. It is usually best to roll them into the canyon. The road is narrow. To swerve might make more dead. By the glow of the taillight, I stumbled back of the car and stood by the heap, a doe, a recent killing. She had stiffened already, almost cold. I dragged her off. She was large in the belly. My fingers touching her side brought me the reason. Her side was warm. Her fawn lay there, waiting, alive, still, never to be born. Beside that mountain road, I hesitated. The car aimed ahead its lowered parking lights. Under the hood, purred the steady engine. I stood in the glare of the warm exhaust turning red. Around our group, I could hear the wilderness listen. I thought hard for all of us, my only swerving, then pushed her over the edge into the river.
Wow, it's certainly clear what all the accolades are about. What marvelous readings, amazing and inspiring. And let's give a round of applause again for our panelists and our wonderful readers. And I want to invite you now next door in the Andersen Library, Elmer's Place, as we like to think of it. Where we have a reception hosted by Graywolf Press. And also a time for you to see the exhibit we've talked about, The World of Voices. It's on the second and third floors of Andersen Library. And also we'll have Graywolf Press books for sale over there as well. I hope you will join us, and thank you again for coming this evening. Good night.